네, 여러분 안녕하세요.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am the MC of the program today. I am announcer Lee Young-ah of MOU Uni TV. It's nice to meet you today. The DMC Global Forum 2020 is being held in order to form consensus on the DMC Peace Zone and find ways to contribute to inter-Korean cooperation and the border area development and find ways to cooperate with the international community. This event is the third international event being hosted by the Ministry of Unification of Korea. This year's theme is Peace Blooming in the DMC. It is being held here in Cheonwon, the land of peace. We have specialists and activists on DMC and border issues from home and abroad who will discuss ways to have inter-Korean reconciliation and cooperation and for peaceful use of the DMC. And this is being held as an online-offline event, and it can be viewed on live via the YouTube channel of MOU Uni TV. We'd like to begin with the opening remarks from Minister of Unification Lee In-young, who is the host of the DMC Global Forum. Please welcome him with a warm hand. It's nice to meet you today. I am Minister of Unification Lee In-young. I'd like to welcome everyone to the DMC Global Forum 2020. Governor of Gangwon Province, Choi Mun-soon, although he was not able to make it personally today, I'd like to thank you and Vice Governor Kim Sung-ho and Lee Hyun-jung, Mayor of Cheonwon, and other officials of Gangwon Province and Cheonwon County, and also to all other participants, I'd like to thank you for your passion and dedication to establishing peace on the Korean Peninsula and improving inter-Korean relations. And to our keynote speaker, GPPAC Executive Director Darinel Rodriguez-Torres, thank you. And our moderator of the symposium, Choi Won-gyu, Director of Institute of Trans-Division Border Studies. And to all the experts and peace activists who are participating online and offline, I'd like to begin by thanking you all. Particularly, this forum is being held in this beautiful borderland of Cheonwon, and we are indeed very pleased to be able to do so. Cheonwon is the site of pristine natural environment and living legacy of history. It is the global site of migratory birds, former capital of Taebong, and the first capital of Goryeo, and it has relics from ancient times to modern history. So it is a living museum of memory. It is also the site of the fiercest battle during the Korean War, and through the 919 Pyongyang Joint Declaration, there was deep mining activities and the recovery of remains of fallen soldiers at the Arrowhead Bridge right here in Cheonwon. So it to share the special nature of border area, which has both division and peace, we decided to have a pre-event unification walk at this year's forum. So the participants walked along the DMZ through the Paengmagoji Battle Memorial Tower, Geumgangsan Railroad Bridge, and were able to have a vivid experience of the ecology and the peace in this region. Ladies and gentlemen, as it is known well, the DMZ was born on July 27, 1953 with the signing of the Armistice Agreement. It is a military buffer zone. Although the gunfires between the two Koreas have stopped, we don't have complete end of war and complete peace. And for a long time, the DMZ has remained as the most heavily armed region in the world and remains a forbidden boundary until today. The DMZ recently, however, has begun to change as a site for inter-Korean reconciliation and cooperation. In 2018, the leaders of the two Koreas, through the Panmunjom Declaration and the 919 Comprehensive Military Agreement, agreed on practical measures on the DMC Peace Zone. And President Moon Jae-in, at his keynote speech at the UN General Assembly last year, proposed that the two Koreas and the international community turned the DMZ into an international peace zone. And thus, bold imagination to realize the value of DMZ has begun. And now we have to ensure that this change spreads throughout the two Koreas and the entire Korean Peninsula. North and South Koreas are a life and safety community that live on the single body called the Korean Peninsula. And we now have to take note of the possibilities of the DMZ as a site for cooperation and realizing collaboration on epidemic prevention, health, climate change, and others. Oftentimes, in talking about the future of DMZ, we cite the German Green Belt to Greenest Bund, and it is the border between the East and West Germanies, and it was a site of change from Iron Curtain to Life Belt. But the Greenest Bund is only 50 to 200 meters wide, but the DMZ is 4 kilometers wide and 248 kilometers long. It is a much bigger and very dynamic space. There are 6 rivers, 1 plain, and 2 mountain ranges. So it is a very diverse space, which means that very diverse collaborative initiatives will be possible here. To overcome disasters and human and livestock diseases that cross borders, we needed to find ways to have collaboration and coexistence with the two Koreas right here in the DMZ. And we need to open up the waterway of peace through the joint use of the shared rivers and the Han River estuary. I believe that if the two Koreas hold hands, then the DMZ will become an experimental space for mutual prosperity where we can have prior experience of peace and prosperity on the Korean Peninsula. Last month, there was a very unfortunate incident in the West Sea in which our citizen has died. And we feel very regretful about this incident, and the government will fulfill its duty to the utmost of its ability. But it was an opportunity to once again realize that the border areas is and peace and cooperation, the border areas, is the beginning of Korean Peninsula peace and coexistence. As soon as the condition of the environment is set, we have to find ways to cooperate on the border areas. And I propose to the North Korean side to implement the agreements between the leaders of the two Koreas. And internally also, we will establish a triangle cooperative system whereby the central local governments and the local community participate, and we will have effective and legal and systemic frameworks in place. In particular, we have to remember the local residents who are the other central figures in the border areas. During the past 70 years of division, this place has been known as a border of silence. However, the DMZ was a site of livelihood and life for many people. And the local residents here in the border area have endured long isolation and delay in progress. And we hope that through DMZ peaceful cooperation, they will also share in genuine prosperity and growth. And there will be ways for us to have sustainable development of this region. On the issues of women, youth, and others that is important to the DMZ peace zone, we will ensure that there will be more opportunities to engage in discussions and cooperation. Ladies and gentlemen, the birds and the flowers and the trees in the DMZ have built a site of life going beyond the incomplete peace and barbed wires artificially set by humans. Yesterday, in front of the DMZ, we had to turn back our footsteps. But today, we must continue our efforts to make this change site from confrontation and Cold War to reconciliation and coexistence. And through this, tomorrow, we will be able to walk the path of complete peace, going beyond the truce line to the northern part of the DMZ. And we look forward to much discussion on peace blooming in the DMZ at today's forum. I take this opportunity to share with you my hope that there will be sharing a vision on ways to cooperate and for sustainable development on the DMZ. I would like to end by wishing all of you health and happiness. Thank you very much.
Bye. 네, 장관님 소중한 말씀.
Minister Lee Inyoung, thank you very much for your invaluable comments. Once again, a big round of applause for the minister, please. Next, I would like to invite Mr. Kim Sung-ho, Vice Governor for Administrative Affairs of Gangwon Province. He will be delivering his congratulatory remarks. A big round of applause, please. Very nice to meet you all. I'm Kim Sung-ho, Vice Governor for Administrative Affairs of Gangwon Province. I would like to extend my congratulations with all of the citizens of Gangwon Province of the 2020 DMZ Global Forum. And I am also deeply grateful to Minister of Unification Lee In-young for making today possible. And I would also like to extend my gratitude to Director Wang Gyu Choi, Standing Representative Chung Soo Kim, Chairman Pyong Woo An, and Deputy President Chung Ho Nam, and also Mr. Lee Yong Jin for coming to this prestigious conference. As you are very well aware, Gangwon Province is the only divided province in the world that embraces the DMZ, and the province experienced directly the pain and tension of division. And for the past 70 years, the DMZ, unlike its original role, was a field of military confrontation as well as anxiety and tension. However, with the Pyeongchang Winter Olympics of 2018, we've been able to see a thawing of relations. It has led to multiple joint declarations, including the Pyongyang Joint Declaration of September 2018 and the Inter-Korean Comprehensive Military Agreement signed on September 19th. This has provided the conditions for joint excavations of Korean War remains by demilitarizing Panmunjom and removing mines in the Arrowhead Hill area. In addition, a dismantling of guard posts along the DMZ allows citizens to enjoy the DMZ Peace Trail. You can see that now it's transforming to a space of signifying war and conflict into a space characterized by peace and hope. The Gangwon Province, at the forefront of peace and prosperity, aspires to engage in multiple projects, including the 2024 Gangwon Winter Youth Olympics, the opening of the Sokcho-Wonsan Sea Route, as well as cooperation relating to emergency relief and public health. I would like to ask for the active support of the minister as well as those here today for these efforts. Through this meaningful forum, I truly hope that we can create DMZ as a field of peace as well as hope. I hope insightful discussions are underway. And once again, congratulations to the forum. And I wish you all good health and happiness. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Vice Governor, for your congratulatory remarks. Please give him another warm round of applause. Although inter-Korean exchanges and cooperation is at a temporary standstill right now, there has been continued discussion on the role that civil society should play in inter-Korean cooperation with regards to peace. So as our keynote speaker, we have invited Executive Director of GPPAC, Darinel Rodriguez-Torres. GPPAC is an international civil society network established in 2005, and with the purpose of civil society capacity building for peace on the Korean Peninsula in Northeast Asia, its Northeast Asia network has been leading the Ulaanbaatar process from 2015, in which civil society from the two Koreas, China, US, Russia, Japan, Mongolia have been participating. So today, under the title of the role of NGOs for peace on the Korean Peninsula and in Northeast Asia, the executive director will give us a speech.
Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on where you're watching. It is an honor to be here today and to be invited to address and to share some of my perspectives into this global forum. I would like to express my appreciation to the Ministry of Reunification of the Republic of Korea for this invitation. As I was preparing for this presentation, I was thinking back at the first time that I heard about Korea or the Korean conflict. And my memories took me back to my childhood when I was about 8 years old. And I overheard a conversation from my grandfather with somebody, and he was telling this person that he had a friend who had fought in the Korean War. Of course, at the time, I did not know much about war. I did not know about Korea, what Korea was or where Korea was. And I didn't understand why would a Colombian soldier travel thousands of kilometers to fight a war in Korea. Little that I knew, 30 some years later, I would be working on issues related to peace and security to try to understand war, its causes, its development, its dynamics, mainly in order to prevent it and to be able to provide or to resolve it effectively. And I didn't know that I would be working and facilitating or helping contributing to a dialogue process engaging participants from North Korea, South Korea, China, Japan, Russia, the US, Mongolia, trying to think ways out of the crisis and trying to propose solutions that could help us to move, put the war behind and to move forward together into a new, brighter future for the Korean Peninsula. I'm going to make 3 points today, 3 points that come from my own reflection, but that mainly come also from what I've gathered from my participation in this Ulaanbaatar process, in this dialogue process that we have been hosting, and my exchanges with participants from all different countries in the region. The first point I want to make is about the need to really seize the moment. I think we are in a new, in a unique political moment that we could even think of 4 years, 3 years, even 3 years ago. We couldn't think of the advances and the developments that have taken place over the past 2 years that could lead us to a peaceful resolution of the conflict in the Korean Peninsula. When I think about the current political context, I cannot help but thinking about 1972, when President of the United States, Richard Nixon, traveled to China in an effort to normalize US-China relations. At the time, the analyst said, just somebody like Nixon could do something like this. Only Nixon could do this. And they referred to that as that hardline politician who can take bold action to change a political course and to really unlock a situation that has been stalled for years. And I feel that in this past couple of years, we have been in a very similar scenario where we are so close to a resolution and we are so close to having the political leaders of the US, of North Korea, of South Korea, taking that decisive political action that could help us move the situation forward and put this conflict behind. So as we do this, and considering the situation that we have had, we really need to seize the moment. We really need to keep the momentum of this. We really need to take advantage of the situation and build on the progress that has been achieved over the past couple of years. That is the first reflection. That is my hope. And whoever is the president of the United States, which will be elected now in the coming month of November, I hope that they can really see the situation like the unique opportunity it is and continue their engagements with the presidents of South Korea, with the leader of North Korea, and to really move the situation forward and really seize the moment that we have right now. The second point I wanted to make was about the urgent need to put an end to the war. We need to begin by putting an end to the war. When we look at the situation in the Korean Peninsula, I can think of mainly three scenarios. One scenario, which is of course the military solution. That to me is a non-viable scenario. That's a scenario that would be so costly in terms of human suffering, in terms of the huge cost of war, that we cannot even think of that. To me, that's a scenario that we all need to discard. Second scenario would be to keep the status quo. And keeping the status quo has also many risks. In a situation so volatile, so uncertain, where the situation can go at any time into an escalation that could actually lead to a nuclear conflict, keeping the status quo is also not a very good option. So if the military solution is not an option, and keeping the status quo is also not an option, there is really one possible way that we need to go, and that is to normalize relations among the US, North Korea, South Korea, and that will bring a virtuous cycle in which we bring the whole region into a more peaceful conditions and moving forward into a peaceful, into the development of a peace agreement. But in order to do that, in order to move towards normalizing relations, we need to put a formal end to the Korean War. That's the only way to provide security assurances to all the regions so that we can start moving forward and building into a moment that can help us bring the momentum to moving to peaceful conditions, moving to a potential de-escalation of the nuclear scenario in the region, hopefully build in the future a nuclear free zone in Northeast Asia, and even move towards reunification of the Korean Peninsula. I would like to make or to bring here a quote of one of the participants in the Ulaanbaatar process who referred to this issue. He said in 2017, in one of the rounds of talks that we have as part of this process, once a legal guarantee for peaceful coexistence between the DPRK and the US is provided by the conclusion of a peace agreement, not only can DPRK-US relations, but also DPRK-Japan and North and South Korea relations be resolved. So if we are talking about building confidence, if we are talking about normalizing relations, putting a formal end would be a very significant step to move in that direction. Third point I want to make is about the role of civil society organizations, global civil society, regional civil society, national civil society, in supporting peace efforts in the Korean Peninsula. When we have such complex situation like the one that we have in the region, it is normal to have ups and downs. It's normal to have moments of high hope, of high expectations, and it's normal to have moments of disappointment. But what we need to do all the time is to be permanently engaged, to provide those platforms for dialogue, for conversations, for bringing people together, for understanding where people and policies are coming from. And that's a role that civil society can play. And that's a role that we have been able to play over the past 5 years. Talking about ups and downs, two steps forward, one step back, we saw how the region had this dialogue mechanism to discuss security issues, the six-party talks. But once the six-party talks were suspended, we needed to keep a place for engagement. We needed to keep a platform for dialogue, at least, if not with officials, at least with extra-officials or with other representatives of the societies from the countries involved. We saw this opportunity at GPAC, and I'm happy that we have been able to support the efforts of our members from the region, from Northeast Asia, to provide this platform for dialogue. That's how in 2015 we launched the Ulaanbaatar process, bringing together civil society participants from South Korea, North Korea, China, Russia, the US, Japan, and Mongolia as the country that hosts our dialogues, in order to discuss security concerns in Northeast Asia, in order to develop a joint understanding of how we could address those security concerns and how we could provide policy recommendations that can be then translated to decision makers in different countries, in different regional and multilateral institutions, trying to think together of ways to move forward into a peaceful situation in the region. So that is one of the contributions that us as civil society and my organization in particular have been able to do. As part of that dialogue process, I have personally had the opportunity to visit both South Korea and North Korea in different opportunities. Just last year, actually a year, almost a year exactly right now, we had the chance to take a delegation from peace builders from different parts of the world into the DPRK to learn about the situation in the DPRK, but also to bring their perspectives from their work as peace builders coming from Brazil, from Africa, from Palestine, from Georgia, from many different places in the world, showing what the work peace builders is, trying to think what part of their experiences could be applicable to the situation, and bringing us this exchange where we learn what the situation is, but we also provide information and knowledge about the work and what has worked in different parts of the world. This is also a two-way street, because not only we take international delegations to the DPRK, we have also had delegations from the DPRK visiting us in our headquarters in The Hague, where they have been able, again, to learn how an international peacebuilding organization works. They have been able to engage with political decision makers from different governments, from the European Union. They have been able to meet with members of the academia, from think tanks, etc., and really learn and see their and share their perspectives, but also learn how they're being perceived and how some of the work that these different institutions are doing in these parts of the world could be useful to unlock and to contribute to the situation in the Korean Peninsula. So this is one role that civil society organizations can play. The second very important role is advocacy. We need to show really our political leaders what policy options there are. We need to advocate for peaceful resolution to the conflict. We really need to keep the momentum and keep the political pressure so that there is political decision, this political decisiveness, this political will that is needed remains there, and that we can move forward and complement official dialogue and diplomatic efforts to bring all the parties together and think together of a solution. We have, of course, been doing that as part of the Ulaanbaatar process, sharing with different political decision makers the conclusions of our dialogue. But we are, of course, not the only civil society actors who are active in this. There are different initiatives that are very effective in putting the focus of the international community into the need of finding a resolution to the Korean Peninsula security issue. I would like to acknowledge an initiative that I'm really fascinated, and I think it makes a great contribution, which is, you know, women across the DMZ. It's amazing how they have managed really to put the attention of the international community of the role of women and to generate this people-to-people interaction, bringing people together to make a difference, to see how together, coming together, not only from the two Koreas, but from all over the world, making a point and bringing different voices into the need of solving this conflict. There's also a very important initiative that is right now being developed by over 300 organizations in Korea, the Korea Peace Appeal. It is very important that these kind of initiatives continue. And I would like to use this opportunity to call on the different civil society organizations working on peace building and on other issues, and on different governments and multilateral institutions to really support what this Korea Peace Appeal is trying to do. And hear what the leaders of this international initiative are trying to say and really act on some of the recommendations that they are suggesting. So to conclude, engagement and dialogue and not isolation or sanctions and military threats are the cornerstone of the solution in the Korean Peninsula. We need to put a formal end to the Korean War. By doing this, we can provide security assurances that will be a very significant step in de-escalating tensions and providing really strong foundations for the construction of a peace process in the Korean Peninsula and in the whole region. Opening channels for interaction, for exchanges at different levels is also very important. This means the reestablishment of diplomatic relations, especially bringing back North Korea into the diplomatic community. This means their effective engagement into multilateral forums. This means supporting efforts for the insertion of North Korea in the global economy. All of this, of course, is easier said than done, but they do require one very specific thing, and that is decisive, bold political action. Yes, these are changes in the foreign policy of different actors, but these changes can take place very quickly when political will is there. I'm convinced that the combination of political action, diplomatic effort, citizens' engagement can help us to overcome the situation that has been going on for decades and open a new stage in the relations of North Korea, South Korea, the US, and in general, in bringing a new moment, a new stage, a new time for the Northeast Asia region to develop a region safer, more secure, free of nuclear weapons, and that can open up a path for the reunification of the Korean Peninsula. These are my hopes, and I would like to end with a quote from one of those members of the Colombian military who traveled to Korea to fight the war. He just mentioned something like, after seeing my war, the war in North Korea, in Korea, I don't wish a war to anybody. War is something horrendous. And I believe that the goal of humanity is not to wage wars, but to overcome our differences and to work together towards peaceful resolution of our conflicts. And I hope that war can be nothing more but a sad memory to me and to everybody. So I hope that this situation, this long-standing conflict that has been taking place in the Korean Peninsula, very soon can be nothing more but a sad memory. And that together with especially the efforts of the people of Korea, but with the support of the international community, including international civil society, that we can make a contribution into making a safer, a more prosperous, nuclear-free region in Northeast Asia, which will set an example for the rest of the world. I hope these words kick off an interesting conversation and interesting discussions in today at this forum, and I would like to reiterate my appreciation and my gratitude for this invitation. I wish you have very fruitful discussions, and I send you my warm greetings and my best wishes for finding a peaceful resolution very soon to the situation in the Korean Peninsula. Thank you.
The value of peace on the Korean Peninsula, and as the main agents of peaceful cooperation on the Korean Peninsula, what role the civil society should be playing. That was some food for thought provided to us by the Executive Director of GPPAC. Please give Mr. Darinel Rodriguez-Torres another warm round of applause. So this time around, we will have a photo session to commemorate.
네, 감사합니다. 그럼 이상으로
Thank you very much. So this concludes the opening ceremony of the DMC Global Forum 2020. For those of you who will participate in this symposium, which will follow right after, please come up the stage and take your seats. Next, under the theme of peace blooming in the DMC, we will have a symposium with experts from home and abroad. And the moderator of the symposium is Wang Yuche, director of the Institute of Transdivision and Border Studies at Shinan University. So I will turn over the microphone to him. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am the moderator of session one. Or the symposium, Wang Yuche. It's actually something that I didn't expect. I have been injured, so I am temporarily disabled. So after this accident, I was thinking that it could be the same for inter-Korean reconciliation, peace, and unification, that it can happen overnight, unexpectedly. The theme of this year's forum is peace blooming in the DMC. And in thinking about this topic, I was reminded of a poem, a famous poem, by the famous poet Choi Young-mi. And the line goes, the poem goes, flowers blooming, it may be difficult, but flowers dying or fading, it happens overnight. We don't have enough time to appreciate the flower. We have no time to think about the flower for days, and they just fade away very quickly. So I think this sort of reflects the efforts of blooming peace on the Korean Peninsula. And in 2018, we did see the result of long-term efforts. We saw some temporary blooming, but in just 1 year, this flower of peace suddenly has faded also. And so that is the situation that we are faced with right now. And so through the forum today, we hope to find ways to once again make peace bloom in this region. So that is what we are trying to discuss in this symposium. Globally, there are a lot of different border areas that exist, but in terms of something that is not made naturally, something that stems from ideological differences, borders that was established artificially, when time passes, one day, someday, these kinds of artificial borders are bound to be demolished. So I have this belief. So beginning from 1945, this year is the 75th anniversary of division. So you may think, well, looking at the situation from the perspective of that poem that I just introduced to you, we can think of this as a temporary situation, because we do think that one day, someday, we're going to have this border fall down. And so with that in mind, we hope to proceed with this session. And we have about 90 minutes for this symposium. So I will begin by introducing to you the panelists of this session. We have a lawyer, Song Jeon, who is currently... He is someone from Cheolwon, this area, and he is a director of the Institute of Border Area. So he's someone that I've known for a long time, and so he really puts in all his efforts. He has great passion for peace on the border area. And the next panelist is Mi So Kim, executive director of the DMZ Peace Train Music Festival. So we have Director Mi So Kim with us also. So through the medium of arts, she is dealing with the topic of peace on the Korean Peninsula. And the two panelists that I just introduced, they are here personally, but then our other two panelists are connected via online. We have Lisa Paletti Clark, co-president of International Peace Bureau. Good morning. And we also have Dr. Dongjin Kim, who is currently at Trinity College Dublin. He is an ISC fellow in Peace and Reconciliation Studies. On peace on the Korean Peninsula, he has written many remarkable papers. And currently, he was selected as a goodwill ambassador from the Ministry of Unification. So we look forward to his role for peace on the Korean Peninsula in the future. So first, we'd like to give the panelists an opportunity to give their presentations. So they have submitted papers beforehand, but they will select the most important parts and talk for about 5 to 6 minutes each. And then later on, we will give them another opportunity to give more detail to their introductory remarks later on for about 5 to 6 minutes each by giving them opportunity for the panelists to speak with each other. And then lastly, I will open up the floor to accept questions and comments and listen to the answers from the panelists. So first, I'd like to ask Song Jeon, director of the Institute of Border Area, for your presentation. Thank you very much for coming to this meaningful event, for engaging in this meaningful exchange of ideas. I will very briefly tell you about some thoughts that I've had on this topic. President Moon Jae-in At the 2019 UN General Assembly proposed the DMZ International Peace Zone. So he gave a very strong proposal at that event, and in this year's New Year's address, he emphasized this once again. In a way, you can say that the DMZ peace zone discussions have been going on for a long time. In 1971, for actual demilitarization of the DMZ, the UN command already gave a proposal back in 1971, and President No Tae-woo also proposed a peace initiative for this region during his term. And recently, President Park Geun-hye also at the UN General Assembly proposed the initiative to make the DMZ an ecological and peace zone. So these initiatives and policies have been put forth over a long period of time, which shows that our entire nation has this great yearning to make the DMZ as an international peace zone, and many different administrations have shown support for this yearning that the public, our nation has. And yet, looking at the recent events in the Arrowhead Ridge developments in Chalwon, and we have had some developments, but we have not had any fundamental changes happen in this region. So we continue to be in a state of war and in a state of retreat. And so what I want to propose at this forum is the DMZ Peace Zone Initiative is not limited to this 4 kilometer wide area, because if we narrow our focus down, we cannot find fundamental solutions to this, to implementing or realizing this initiative. So yesterday during the fireside chats, we did have an expert talk about this issue. Very naturally, this 4 kilometer DMZ area and the CC northern part of the civilian control zone, and they should be connected organically, very naturally, in developing this area. And as our initiatives become an initiative, they have to blend in with our socio-economic initiatives. So we have to have that in mind as the starting point of developing this area. And another emphasis that I want to make is the following. This DMZ Peace Zone Initiative, for it to maintain momentum. But what we've seen so far is we've seen a lot of setbacks. And the reason for these often setbacks is that the DMZ itself has been set following the armistice, and with the efforts of the South Korean government alone, we cannot overcome the related issues, because there are many other elements involved, including the regional and international politics. And so we cannot separate the DMZ area alone in dealing with this issue. The DMZ zone should be seen from this broader perspective. And the paper that I submitted already has these ideas written down. This 4 kilometer width in the DMZ, if we just limit our discussions in this narrow area, then we won't make much progress. As Dr. Lee mentioned yesterday, we have to include all of the naturally connected areas. And so socioeconomically, we cannot separate these areas. They have to be integrated organically. And so whatever plans we have in mind in implementing them, we have to remember that this is an organically connected area. Let me repeat myself. We cannot talk about the DMZ in and of itself, because there's so many inter-Korean and international political military issues involved in this region. And so if we just separate the DMZ area alone, we will have very fragmented results. And so the basic concept that we have in mind is that the DMZ includes this broad area. The DMZ, the CCZ, the border areas, they have to be seen as an integrated area in our future initiatives and plans. So that is the gist of my message today. So the DMZ area alone, we've already had a lot of good things that we talked about, a lot of efforts being inserted for the DMZ areas per se. So for me, I want to connect that with the broader border areas, and that I feel will be very important in the future. My time is up, so let me conclude here. Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Song Jun. So since he is from this border areas, he is someone who has really felt the situation, experienced the situation that the border area is faced right now. So I think his statement stems from his personal experience. Next, I would like to invite from Dublin, Ireland, from the Trinity College, Dr. Dong Jin Kim. He will be talking about Northern Ireland peace process and the Korean Peninsula. Typically, when we talk about the peace process of the Korean Peninsula, typically we would cite the German example. However, from 2-3 years back, we've been seeing the case of Ireland receiving the spotlight as an experience that can actually resonate with us. Therefore, we would like to look into the possibility of adopting the peace process of Northern Ireland to the Korean Peninsula. And Dr. Kim is at the forefront in terms of having that experience grafted to Korea. So I will give you 6 minutes. Please give us your presentation on the Northern Ireland peace process and its relevance with the Korean Peninsula. Dr. Kim?
발표.
Yes, please proceed with your presentation. Moderator, thank you very much. Director Choi, thank you very much for your kind words, and I would like to share my screen with you. I don't think I have the authority to share my screen, so if you can give me the authority to share my screen via Zoom, I would be grateful. Thank you very much. Yes, as introduced, I am currently with the Trinity College Dublin, and I would like to brief you on the Northern Ireland peace process. The peace process, as you are very well aware, is a journey towards peace in a conflicted areas, and it consists of multiple phases, but the most important phase has to do with signing a peace treaty, but there are also the pre-negotiations and the post-negotiations phase. And I think that it's important to understand the phases. And as was mentioned by Director Choi, the Northern Ireland peace process is receiving the spotlight these days. And it has to do with certain historical similarities, because if you look at Ireland, it was divided. And with regard to peace and unification, there were some similar commonalities, for instance, a colonial history. Next year would be the centennial of the divide of Ireland. But you can see that there are some differences as well, because they successfully forged a peace agreement in 1998. And their experience towards a peace agreement has actually received a lot of interest in areas of conflict. Of course, Ireland's peace process did go through many ups and downs, and there were multiple agreements and communique, and there were some issues with implementation. However, in 1998, they were able to sign a peace treaty, and I think that this actually gives us hope as a peace process for us to seek some relevance. But even after the peace agreement, there were some tribulations. But still, you can see that there were sustained agreements to find a way to keep the ball rolling to implement the already signed agreement. This slide indicates a part of the agreement of 1998, and you can see that I have a clause here on the slide in English, and it indicates that it is for the people of Ireland alone, by agreement between the two parts respectively and without external impediment, to exercise their right of self-determination on the basis of consent freely and concurrently given North and South, to bring about a united Ireland, accepting that this right must be achieved and exercised with and subject to the agreement and consent of a majority of the people of Northern Ireland. So you can see that it's based on mutual trust, and in the process of negotiations, you can see that there may be hostilities, but the agreement indicates that it has to be inclusive. And in addition to that, geopolitically speaking, you can see that the EU and the US played an important intermediary role to enable Ireland to sign this peace agreement of 1998. So you can see that it was based on a principle of peaceful coexistence and principle of mutual respect. And the role of civic society was key. There was a referendum to put to vote this peace agreement. You can see the icons of yes and no to the right. This was a poster where it indicates the role and the efforts of the civic society, and they were promoting this peace agreement to the citizens. And they mentioned that it's important to check to yes if we really want to find a hopeful future. So once again, the role of civic society was critical. So between the North and South, especially in the border areas, you can see that the military demarcation line was withdrawn. And as you can see here in the pictures, there were free passage between the North and South. Of course, the two are still very different in terms of the national systems, and different sovereignty exists. However, you can see that they opened up, and free passage of both the North and South is possible. Recently, due to the Brexit, you can see that some were cautious as to that we might be seeing barriers built up again on this demarcation line. But you can see that more than six times the trucks have to go back and forth to actually do anything together. So you can see that there's a lot of exchange and cooperation ongoing. And here, and within Northern Ireland, there are still some conflicts. Although we're seeing this peace process underway, there were some conflict groups where, with some more exchange, you can see that based on the contact theory and through exchange and cooperation, they went through a process of understanding and also acknowledging their national identity. So that's a pro. However, another con would be that hostility can actually exacerbate, because they would go into who has been benefiting more to the peace process. So within the conflict groups, both internally and externally, you can see that in Northern Ireland, another wall is set. And you can see that there are some internal disputes that are intensifying. So amid such a situation, the point I would like to make is that it's been more than 20 years since the peace agreement, but now we have the new generation emerging. We do have open borders between the North and South. However, in the Northern Ireland community, still there are existing hostilities. So under such a situation, peace education is important. You can see some pictures here where the educator or the teacher is asking what's leading to conflicts. And you can see that the teenagers of the Northern Ireland indicate that the existing generation has led to such a divide. And you can see that there are those that have different identities based on religion. So we have the Protestants as well as the Catholics. And they have, well, different perspectives and views. But this next generation is saying that we have to now go forward. We have to join hands. So because they're receiving this peace education and training, they can actually think in an integrated fashion. However, there are, of course, certain groups that want to intensify a stalemate perspective to have this hostility go on. However, you can see that what's happening here is sometimes there are maybe groups that may lead to go through the extreme end of the spectrum. So this example of North Ireland implies that first it's important to lower the borders and find a way to coexist. So this, of course, offers a hopeful message. However, we need thorough preparation. And even after the peaceful agreement, there may be hostilities remaining. Therefore, it's important to make sure that we respect the identity and find a way to reconcile. So such peaceful reconciliation as well as efforts will be necessary even after the peace agreement. Thank you. Dr. Kim, thank you very much for your comments. You talked about Ireland's peace process and also whether this can actually be applied to the Korean example. Yanitaro Tadayo was a major figure in colonial rule, indicated that Joseon is the island of Japan. In other words, you can see that Ireland and Korea that has actually experienced this divide will have to go through multiple challenges to really enable peace. This Good Friday Agreement or this peace process was possible due to George Mitchell, the Senate member. And if you look at his book, Making Peace and Progress, it indicates that his role was to listen. In other words, you can see that it was about listening to the words of the directly impacted. So Mr. George Mitchell's words were the following of the importance of listening. To resolve conflict and to bring about peace, you can see that it's important to understand unconditionally the position of the other. So in the second round, I hope that we can have some further discussions on the peace process of Northern Ireland. Next, our third panelist is Lisa Clark, co-president of IPB. You have about 5 to 6 minutes for your presentation. Please go ahead.
Good morning to you all. It's very morning for me because it's not 3 o'clock in the morning right now. I'm trying to share my... Oh, there it is. Have you got it? Yes. I think so. I hope you've got my screen. Yeah. Perhaps somebody can help me make it larger. I don't know how to do this. But anyway, there it is. I'm very grateful and humbled to have been appointed a Goodwill Ambassador, but I'm also very grateful to have been invited to this conference called Blooming Peace. I've given it a more determined title, which is Let Peace Bloom. I think that should express our determination. But listening to what's been said so far, I thought that maybe I should change my title into Turning a Border into a Bridge, because I think that's what we all really want to do. I wish I could get my slides up there, but I don't quite know how to do that. Maybe somebody can do it from there. There it is. And that was about the, there we are, the International Peace Bureau, of which I am co-president. It's an elected office, and I'm in my second mandate. Unlike my colleagues, I'm not an expert on the Korean Peninsula, but I do feel that I can contribute in two ways. I can contribute information on the experiences of women elsewhere in conflict and post-conflict situations, and we have heard how important the role of women is in other situations. We've heard that both from the keynote speaker and, of course, from our friend Dr. Kim from Dublin. In my long life, I've been involved in many actions, plans, programs for building peace across borders and among peoples who have been separated by war, and for establishing the conditions for reconciliation after violence, separation, and war. Although each situation is unique, I have no doubt that some of the stories I could share with you may provide interesting ideas and encouragement to Korean individuals and groups. In Sarajevo, Bosnia, where I lived during the war, during the siege, the women of the besieged center of the city reached out to the women on the other side of the river. There, too, there was a bridge that marked a border, and it was the front line. And together we held up a huge banner which said, "Dear Serbian neighbor, let's stop our husbands," who were the ones fighting the war. I was there, and the worst reaction, I would never have believed it, came from our side. The presidential guard shot against us. We had become traitors because we had spoken to the enemy. This is the war mentality. So I really feel that being somewhere where you can create, turn a border into a bridge, is absolutely essential in terms of resilience to the war mentality, and women can do that. I have several other examples in the written paper, which I won't go through, but I just wanted to talk about, they give us the ideas of how we need to consider that the other is not an enemy, that the person on the other side is the person that we are, that we need to communicate with. My most recent experience is the civil society campaign to introduce a treaty banning nuclear weapons, also very pertinent to the Korean Peninsula, but from another point of view, not necessarily what I'm talking about this evening. But this was, to a large extent, the brainchild of women. It was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 2017, and it proves many things, and it gives us several messages for the women of our future peaceful DFC. We women can succeed in convincing government institutions to act according to our proposals by proving to them that we are not a threat, that we are working for the security of all. We're working for peace and disarmament for all sides. From this point of view, the Women Cross DNZ project was really very, very important, and the women in ICANN supported Women Cross DNZ fully. So I really think that my basic suggestion is that I would like to see the administration of the peaceful DNZ entrusted to women, focusing on the real life of women on both sides of the DNZ, bearing in mind the experiences of other women in other parts of the world. The goal could be to imagine a common future and agree on a common history of the tragic events of the past. I would like to encourage the women involved in administering our peaceful DMZ, like this woman in the picture, who is a survivor of Hiroshima, and she's well in her 80s and has never stopped being active for peace and disarmament in her life, to do all this, but together. The firm and lasting foundations of a future of reconciliation can only be laid by sharing life stories in honesty. This is something that is very important, because that opens us up to mutual trust. We must speak about our suffering and accept other people's stories of pain and loss as well. with the shared goal of building a future together. Now, the second way that I think that I can contribute to the Korean Peninsula peace process is by disseminating abroad information about the history and current experiences in Korea. We heard about George Mitchell telling us that the way to build peace is to listen, listen, listen. Well, I feel that in other countries, especially in Europe where I live, people know very little about historical developments in Korea and practically nothing about the peace actions and proposals of the Korean people. I wish to learn more myself and to offer this opportunity to other foreigners so we can inform peace-loving groups and individuals about the Korean reality, and if possible, also foster contacts and international meetings amongst the young. I would love to attend a seminar in our peaceful DMZ on the entire history of the Korean peace process from President Nobel Peace Laureate Kim Dae-jung's Sunshine Policy to the inter-Korean summits to the present. We non-Koreans have so much to learn, and that will be the best way that we can contribute to the peaceful DMZ. Thank you.
예, Lisa Clark.
Thank you very much, President Lisa Clark. 3 years ago, we had the Women Cross DMZ movement. So there were several women who crossed the DMZ coming from North Korea to down to South Korea. It's something that even men could not do. So the women very boldly crossed the line and they showed this performance. And so we look forward to more discussions during the second round of our panel discussion later on. Last but not least, our fourth panelist, Executive Director Mi So Kim, including myself, those in the social sciences continue on to define a certain phenomenon. However, I once read a book titled What is Music? And it said that music, like love, is not something to be defined, but it's something to be experienced. And I believe Executive Director Kim, with regard to peaceful inter-Korea, will not be trying to define this. I think that she will be giving us her experience of how it can be actually felt via music. So I have had high expectations for your presentation. So Ms. Kim, the floor is yours. It's very nice to meet you all. I am the executive director for the DMZ Peace Train Music Festival. My name is Mi So Kim, and as was mentioned by our moderator, there are many peace experts here today, but for me, I'm not an expert of peace, but rather that of music and arts. This June, in the Gosokjeong Pavilion, and also in the border area, this music festival was to take place, but due to COVID-19, we could not bring this to fruition. But this peace train has actually been up and running for 3 events, and I would like to briefly talk about our history and the role it played in the journey of peace. So you may wonder how this festival was possible at Gosokjeong Pavilion, so I have a short video to share with you, and then I will continue on with my presentation.
월정이요. 고속정에서 제2회 DMZ 피스트레인 뮤직 페스티벌이 개최됩니다.
움직이고 있었지 너무 두근거렸지 아무것도 장담할 순 없었어 손을 잡히지 않는 눈에 보이지도 않는 설명할 수 없는 뭔가 난 상할망했었네 oh, 난 놓치고 싶지 않아 We're waiting for a train drunk from the airport.
Did you imagine something like this would be possible? The parking lot we have outside to this hotel was also a stage, and there's also a small park of patches of grass, and there were two stages there as well. The DMDP's Train Music Festival was to hold its third event this year on the second week of June with the support of Gangwon Province and Chalwon-gun. It was possible. More than 40 teams from 12 countries were involved, and 15,000 participants were with us. Because we don't have a lot of time, I will have to just briefly talk about how this festival came to its being. Ever since the Pyeongchang Olympics and the Inter-Korean Summit, you may think that we actually came to its being due to these two events, but that was not the case. It was 2017 when President Trump and Chairman Kim basically was baring their teeth with the nuclear button in front of them. But I, in Hongdae University, I was involved in the music industry as well as music marketing. There was one individual abroad, and they said that it seems like there's war on the Korean Peninsula, and they were wondering whether they can actually come to Korea, but they did, and they saw that this music festival was quite unlike what we thought in the outside world, because they thought that it was quite unique to see that it seemed like a very dangerous place, but there was so much entertainment and enjoyment. So they thought it would be great to go on a DMZ tour to actually see what it was like on the Korean Peninsula. So we connected them with a Paju DMZ tour. And ever since, you can see that they found the need to actually have this music festival that sings peace. So there was one individual from the UK, and he went back to the UK, and he brought back supporters as partners to hold music festivals in Korea. So that was how this festival was born. And I thought, why did they suggest something like that? You can see that these individuals, ever since the Vietnam War, and those in the 60s actually knew that war was something that we had to get rid of. So they were a part of the resistance movement, and they held many music events in conflict areas. So they had that experience. For us, we know music better than peace. So what we wanted to do is, of course, pay respect to past music, but also identify some new hidden gems of music. And you can see that this was a movement that started off from the private sector, and we also wanted to public partners, so we went to Gangwon Province. And that has led us to this partnership of Gangwon Province and Chalwon-gun, and we started this festival. In the DMZ border area, we've thought that Chalwon would be the ideal place because, you know, Chalwon has many historic relics. There are many resources that we can actually see and feel. And if you look at many rock festivals, you can see that there are many younger generations that are involved. However, if you think of the travel, that was also an important logistics point. So that's why we thought of Chalwon, because it's accessible from Seoul. And not only that, it was by coincidence where we had the Pyeongchang Winter Olympics and the Inter-Korean Summit of April 27th. At the time, many of the generation thought that maybe we'd be seeing an end of war, that we may have. And we should enjoy and celebrate the end of war at this peace festival. But with this mood of peace, you can see that there were heightened interest on peace. And I think that this festival played a very important role of a bridge to connect the generations on this notion of peace. So what was peace for us? Of course, I am more on the part of the younger generation compared to the participants here today. So when we think about division and unification, I think that that's not the only way to define peace. There are many aspects, refugees, gender, hatred, as well as exclusion, where these forms of, well, these items actually resonates more with the younger generation. So what we want to do is not generate or regulate or restrict peace. We want to make it more visible, and we want to find a way to really sing peace. So our festival has no headlines. It's not the major artist that would come here. It would more about paying respect to the bounds of the past generations and help unveil hidden gems around the world. So it's about diversity, and it does not discriminate, restrict, or judge. In other words, as mentioned, it does not define peace. It's about listening and looking into the peace that may be different for all of the individuals. So in 2018, these were the musicians that were with us, and in 2019, these are the musicians that participated in the festival. There were many episodes that I wanted to share, but in lieu of time, I think I cannot go into detail. So you can see that we had artists, more than 40 teams for the music performance, but that was not all. You actually went into the Sori Mountain as well as the Ludong Dangsa, the headquarters of the Labor Party. So you can see that what we want to do is create a consensus on the topic of peace. And conferences are also held on the theme of city as well as peace and culture. So we want to continue on to engage in a sustained transmission and visualization of peace. I have some more to say, but I will like to elaborate on that in the second round. Thank you. Yes, thank you, Executive Director Kim, for your invaluable comments. And that was the first round of our four panelists. Thank you very much. And let us now continue on with a second round of presentations and discussions. And in order to go further in depth, I would like to pose some questions. Between the two Koreas, there have been a lot of discussions on DMZ development, a lot of festivals, forums, international conferences held on this topic. But as far as what I feel is that peace always requires a counterpart. But what's missing here is that our counterpart, which is North Korea, I think we are trying to ostracize North Korea. We have tried to make North Korea the other side. Let me share with you my personal experience. In 2018, on April 27, in Panmunjom, the 2018 Panmunjom event commemorative meeting was held. And in the DMZ areas, from the Western frontline to the Eastern frontline, there was a movement to make a belt or make a connection between the two areas. A lot of participants came together in that event. And as I was watching this event last year, I was thinking that the northern part of the DMZ is under the great silence. We couldn't see anyone on the northern part of DMZ, we couldn't hear anything. And so from the southern part of DMZ, we were commemorating the previous year's event, and there was even a music festival. But to the northern part of DMZ, we couldn't sense anyone. We couldn't see anyone, hear anything in the Panmunjom building. So these North Koreans who are inside this building, Panmunjom, in the north, I was thinking about what are they thinking as they watch this commemorative event we are holding on the southern side. So in South Korea, whether it's the conservative or the progressive governments, our government has always saw North Korea as an object of our policy. We tried to make North Korea the other side, the other country. Using our own language, we defined the other side. We gave prescriptions about what the other side should be doing. And as long as we continue this practice, we won't be able to make progress, because we have to give due recognition to the other side to make progress, to have progress on this issue. So in our second round of discussion, the issue of the other side, how can we overcome looking at the opponent as the other? How can we overcome them to have peace and prosperity on the Korean Peninsula? So it will be a time to think about these fundamental issues in round two. Emmanuel Revenes has said that the other is explained through the concept of indefiniteness. So it is something, the other is everything that is not me. And infiniteness means that no system, no jurisdiction, or no range can contain the other. So we always seem to interpret and see the other only from the limits of our own perspectives, from me perspective. So what we have to be really prudent, mindful of as we deal with this topic is that this is a game in which there is an opponent, there is the other side, the counterpart. So we should never for a moment forget that there is the other side. But very unfortunately, in the TMZ area, we've had many events evolve, a lot of different activities, but then oftentimes we are oblivious of the North Korean audience. We've had just our own campaigns and events from the perspective only of South Koreans. So that was the introductory remark that I wanted to share with you. And so in the second round of our discussion, let's go reverse order. So I'd like to ask Dr. Dongjin Kim for your second remarks. We are delayed, so please be very brief with your second remarks.
네, 감사합니다.
Yes, thank you very much, moderator, for your comments. And you also talked about the importance of a peace process of understanding that we do have another counterpart. And if we look at the case of Ireland, the peace process of Ireland was about recognizing and respecting the other and to find a way to be in this together. So I believe that this has led to a peace agreement. And as I have already mentioned, like the Korean Peninsula, there were multiple agreements. But in the process of implementing such agreements, as Director Choi has mentioned, was about understanding and respecting the position and stance of the counterpart. For instance, in 1998, before the peace agreement in South Ireland, there were certain groups that were afraid of unification through absorption. So what happened was there was a lot of discussions on territorial issues, but you can see that the peace process of Ireland may be different, but what's similar is that it's about recognizing the other's sovereignty as well as the other's territory. So you can see that Southern Ireland said that let's recognize each other's sovereignty and then start off with the peace process. And there was also amendments to the constitution. You can see that Ireland, the issues of a united Ireland was something that cannot be decided at one go. And I think that this, of course, cannot be reflected in its fullest to the Korean Peninsula. However, as we research the many peace processes around the world, the key point here is not to mimic or just copy the process as in its original form, but rather it's about finding takeaways and lessons to ask relevant questions to see how this can be useful in any way. So once again, the situation of Ireland and the Korean Peninsula is very different. And in terms of our experience, you can see that it's not about just trying to copy the case of Northern Ireland to the Korean Peninsula, but rather it's about understanding all of these different examples and trying to find the takeaways. As Director Choi has mentioned, especially about respecting the other and understanding the position of the other can actually give us some good food for thought in establishing our own peace process. Thank you. Yes, Dr. Kim, thank you very much for your comments. What was quite inspiring with the Ireland case was when they were signing the Good Friday Agreement, they amended the constitution to make this possible. If you look at the Ireland, the Republic of Ireland, there are clauses on unification and regarding territory, and you can see that the constitution was amended to enable a coexistence of both the north and south. So in other words, until both Ireland's want, unification will not be the case. And if you look at the territorial clauses, it indicates that anyone that was born on Ireland territory will be citizens of Ireland. So with this amendment, you can see that the conflict between both the North and South was alleviated, and any skepticism towards unification by absorption was also lifted as well. So these different groups and different lines had their own divided opinions. However, still the St. Andrew's Agreement and the Good Friday Agreement was signed, and I believe that these efforts were some key catalysts to this peace agreement. Next, I'd like to ask President Clark to give her second round of discussion. Women-led peace movements around the world. What significance would that have on the Korean Peninsula? What proposals would you like to give for the Korean Peninsula? So please go ahead with your statement.
Yes, thank you. Yes, I already mentioned that I feel that the DMZ, the peaceful DMZ zone, should become a bridge rather than a border, and a bridge in which we can talk about our past. But of course that requires, it was implicit for me that we should be talking with the other, as you mentioned it, absolutely essential, that is essential. But that is not something that I can recommend how it could be done. This is just an example, I feel, that we could carry forward. But there is something that I feel that I also put in my paper that I felt perhaps we could start working on. There is an institution in Tuscany, the region of Italy where I live, that offers educational experiences to young people from both sides of a long-standing conflict. Let's call it conflict, not necessarily a war, but a conflict. And there are Palestinians and Israelis, there are Armenians and Azerbaijanis, etc., etc. And I felt that, of course, you would have to help with the Korean side and the DPRK side and the ROK, both sides. We could offer to two young people, or four young people, two from the South and two from the DPRK, a period as students in a completely separate environment, but an environment in which there are other young people who come from geographical regions that have lived through the same experience. The idea is that in full immersion with their peers, they can elaborate better the situation of the countries they come from, because it would be in a larger context. And then, of course, Once they have had that experience of living together, working together, studying together, and with young people from similar situations, they then go back to the countries of origin, to their cities of origin and schools of origin, as peace and goodwill ambassadors, and fulfill that role in their own communities. Naturally, I cannot do this by myself. This is an idea. But I can propose it to the institution, to this educational institution in Italy. And if there is collaboration on your side, and if you feel that this can be done with students from North, from DPRK educational institutions as well, this would be, I think, something that we could work towards. Thank you.
예, 고맙습니다. 니사 회장님.
Thank you very much, President Clark. So indeed, you shared with us very good proposals and ideas which we should heed well. Next, we'd like to invite Director Mi-Soo Kim. I don't think you had enough time for your presentation, so if there are any comments you'd like to add, please proceed. I did have a couple of slides remaining, and I would be grateful if you can pull up those slides for me. With COVID-19, and that of course hindered our efforts to hold festivals, and I may be exaggerating, but what it's that we want to go to places. What happened was participants could not come to Chalwon. And about 2,000 guests, actually, although due to the cancellation, we were very sad, and they sympathized with us. So we can't do what we want, and we can't go where we want, and we can't be together, although we do want to be together. And you can see that with this pandemic, like it's like a war, and I believe that this has made us recollect on division and war and this divide. And this festival was canceled. And you can see that those actually, they contacted us and they wanted to help us out, help the area of Gangwon, where it was flooded, of Igili, Igili town. So you can see that things that really does not impact bringing bread to the table is in many cases otherwise, and we may think that this really does have no relevance with us at all. Some say that North and South is in a stalemate, and this COVID situation, they think that festivals will no longer have any space to stand. But what I want to say is, if we cannot hold these festivals, what will remain, and what kinds of issues will be brought about to the future generation? So this slide indicates that if we see the losses aggregate, it would be about otherizing the other, and you can see that there can be major issues to communication and communion. So you'll be insensitive to communications, to having these face-to-face conversations. There will be this internal scar as a trauma. What I want to say is, as we've seen with the COVID crisis, this division, hatred, and exclusion, the shutting out others, this is all part of this dispute and conflict, and it's about finding harmony in this chaos. And I think that these experiences should not just be done away with. We need to continue on to visualize all of these aspects, and this has to be handed down to the future generation. So I believe that it's important to experience and institutionalize. Due to COVID, as I have already mentioned, we are now experiencing and institutionalizing these calamities or disasters. And we need to make sure to understand the saga and hand down the narrative. And it's about making sure to integrate the positive mindsets and these experiences all together through music and arts. So we will continue on to do that, to make sure that everybody shares in and be a part of this experience. And we want to really put this notion that peace is not that far away and that it's not something that to be otherized, but that we are in this as principal agents. Yes, thank you very much. Last but not least, I would like to ask Director Song Jun.
그민동선이부철과적경제
The border area including the northern part of the CCL is subject to restrictions following UN resolutions and Indo-Korean resolutions. However, if we have the commitment, if we have the dream, and if we sustainably, continuously develop, try to develop this area, we will have fruitful results. And that ultimately will be the foundation to make the DMZ an international peace zone. And so we should, based on our plan and our will, we have to try to develop the entire border area, including the CCL. So the current legal and institutional framework will have to be revised, and that should be our first priority for the moment. And one core effort should be to revise the Military Bases and Installations Protection Act and the Special Act on Support for the Border Areas. The Military Installation Protection Act was enacted after the Korean War. There were slight revisions to date, but the basic framework has not changed. So now we have to do away with this past idea of confrontation. Since we're trying to pursue peace here, we cannot just focus on developing the border area just on the military confrontation issues that is reflected in the current act. So the border area development is in line with the DMZ peace initiative and in line with improving inter-Korean relations. And the standard should not be military standards, it has to be environmental legal standards and peace standards. And with that in mind, we have to revise, have an overall revision of this Military Installations Protection Act. With regards to the Border Area Protection Act, this was based on a German law set during the Kim Dae-jung administration. So the border area residents, they've been subject to sacrifice a lot of on behalf of the entire nation. And so the entire nation should be in solidarity in providing support to the border area residents. But in the case of South Korea, as we enacted and revised this law, there were so many different complicated issues involved. And so we just have the basic framework of this German law in our law, but we don't reflect the spirit in which the German law was enacted. And so it is just a law in name. And it is seen from the perspective or approached from the perspective of regional balance to growth. So the border area is seen as just one remote area in the country that has delayed progress, but that is not the essence of the border area. So for the past 70 years, the border area residents suffered, endured this great pain on behalf of the entire nation. And they now need to receive compensation for this past sacrifice. And for future development of the border area, they have to become a zone for peaceful cooperation and to become a front line for inter-Korean cooperation and reconciliation. And to be able to do so, we have to have very good planning and implementation of the development of this border area. But the current Support Act does not reflect this idea. It's just a means to provide very minimal support to the border area residents. And so I feel that this law on providing support to the local, border region, the administrative entity right now is the Ministry of Interior and Safety. I think that has to change to the Ministry of Unification. And there is also a Border Area Policy Deliberation Committee that has to go under directly under the office of the president. And there has to be some Inter-Korean Border Joint Management Committee established. So this committee has to change to be sort of as part of a preparatory work for future inter-Korean joint management. So what I am trying to drive at is that this law should not reflect the dimensions of just dispensatory or arbitrary support given to this region, but it should reflect the very special status that this border region has. So we need an all-out revision of the current law, and we look forward to the Ministry of Unification playing a major role in these legal revisions. And most importantly, in the border areas, well, the residents of the border areas are part of our national defense capacity. So they are not simply civilians that play no role. In fact, without these border region residents, our military would not receive the needed support to exercise its full capacity. And so it is from this perspective that we have to look at the border area residents and try to develop the border region. And when we are able to do so, when such a momentum is formed and spreads throughout the DMZ region, it'll contribute to making this peace initiative a reality. Thank you very much, Mr. Chun. So you talked about the future direction of the Border Area Support Law and the Military Installations Protection Act. Thank you very much for sharing your valuable words with us today. So we've now had the second round of panelist presentations. We don't have much time remaining. I'm not sure if I remember clearly, but we did not begin exactly at 10:30. We were delayed by about 7 minutes. We began at about 10:37. So, exercising my right as the moderator, we're going to extend this session to 12:10.
We don't have a lot of time remaining. Therefore, I think we can conclude the comments in the presentations of our panelists. And now I would like to give the floor to our online and offline participants. And if you may pose any questions or comments, we will have the panelists to respond. I believe you all agree. Any objections? If there are none, let us proceed. Here, we have many participants with keen interest in peace and prosperity on the Korean Peninsula, and I would like to give you the opportunity to also express any comments or views and also pose questions. Any questions from the floor? And I would like to also ask our online participants, do you have any questions?
Oh, 질문이 화면에?
Oh, I see we have the questions on the screen. I'm not used to this type of conference, so I guess I missed some of the questions. So the questions are here on the screen. So let me now read off a couple of the questions. So for the piece of DMZ, we need to find a way to deal with the stalemate situation of the two Koreas. So what kind of role can the government play? So that's the first question. And the second question has to, that goes to Dr. Kim. For peace on the Korean Peninsula, what is the greatest lesson that we can learn at the current stage from the peace process of Northern Ireland, and particularly on the role of the government? I believe that this is also a very important question. So who would like to answer these questions? Maybe we can have Mr. Chun. Well, I am moderator, therefore I do not have the authority to answer the questions. But if you may delegate the right, I would like to briefly respond to the question posed. Will you be willing to give me that mandate? Yes. Over the past 40 years, I've been involved in inter-Korean relations, studying the Korean Peninsula issues. I have never gone close to the government. It was a way for me to protect myself. So I wasn't really directly involved in government affairs. So I've been very critical of the government, whether it's the conservative or the progressive government. I have been very frank and honest with regard to the government. As I did mention in the introductory remarks, for peace on the DMZ, when the government has to play certain roles to break through the current impasse, you need to change your position, your perspective of the other side. But very fortunately, to date, whatever the inclination of the government we had, all our governments, South Korean governments, just unilaterally defined the other side. And the North Korea proposals from the Southern government oftentimes did not reflect the concerns and difficulties, the situation that North Korea is in right now. Our proposals were very South Korea-centric, so to speak. And so I think we need to have a fundamental assessment of this wrong approach that we've had so far. As a North Korea researcher, I feel that a lot of the proposals from the South Korean side is something that North Korea would find it almost impossible to accept. So we really need to try to understand the North Korean situation. So there was a scholar who did an experiment in Africa, 50, 60 young children. They were put to a running game and they were given a lot of cookies as a prize. So the first place winner would be given cookies as a prize. So the children began to run from the starting line and everyone ran together, holding hands together. Everyone with their hands together ran to the finish line. And the scholar asked the children, why did you all run together? Why didn't you just go ahead alone? They said, I am because you are. You exist. That is why I can exist. That is their basic mentality in Africa. So all of the North Korean policies that does not reflect this mentality is bound to fail. And also, with regards to inter-Korean relationship, we should not have the illusion that, you know, one government has more legitimacy, one government has more support. I mean, so fundamentally, this is a political battle that still continues today. And so even if we have inter-Korean relationship development, fundamentally, there's still that political limitation that exists until we have unification. So I think we have to have that in mind as we try to improve bilateral relations. So our government, South Korean government, whether it's conservative or progressive, I think they are trying to manipulate or use North Korea policies to their advantage too much. But of course, they cannot realistically give a proposal that will be 100% satisfactory to North Korea, but at least, you know, think about the position and the situation that North Korea is in right now in giving proposals. Because if not, if there's no change in this mind shift, we will not have any progress and success. And we will have genuine peace only with this change in this mindset. So that is my appeal to the South Korean government officials. So as someone who has been studying this issue, I just wanted to share with you my views. So next, I would like to ask Professor Dongjin Kim to specifically give us ways to apply the Ireland model to Korea. What are some lessons that we can get from the Irish model?
Thank you. In the North Ireland process, the key implication for the Korean Peninsula is to bring down barriers and, of course, increase exchange. But I want to say that that is not enough. It's about what kind of exchange. That is a very important component to the peace process of Ireland. As mentioned, if you look at the negotiations of the peace process of Ireland, out of the major stakeholders, there was this consensus formed, and they all recognized the situation and position of the counterpart, and that's how this agreement came to its fruition. So I believe that the politicians and also the military officers need to make sure to recognize and acknowledge the other and also form a consensus. If you look at the citizens, we believe that it's very difficult for the citizens to actually acknowledge the other as is, especially those that have experienced a war. You can see that the agreement as well as the amendment to the constitution was put to a referendum, and with the referendum going for a yes, you can see that all of this did happen. But in the process, what we can say is that they knew that peace was important and they said yes. However, in many cases, they weren't ready to meet their counterparty. If you look at the politicians and the military officers, they've been meeting each other for quite a long time. So they had that basis for understanding the others. However, if you look at the citizens, that was not the case. The people did not have enough time to prepare for that meet. And then there was this peace agreement. Therefore, in the process of implementing the peace agreement, there were many difficulties. And in this Brexit situation, in this geopolitical situation exacerbating, it's true that the Ireland people, in order to sustain this peace process, we're not exactly sure because there are question marks on that. Of course, right now, as we do have this clear military demarcation line, of course, we'll have to bring down the barrier and forge a peace agreement and enable free passage and exchange of the North and South. That's what we want. However, what I want to say is it's not just about the peace agreement. We need to understand what kind of exchange, what kind of communion are we looking into for the citizens and the people. That's why the citizens, the civic society has a key role to play, and also the government needs to find a way to not only tackle the political issues, but it's about being not too hasty. It's about having a participatory process of the citizens being involved and engaged as well. So that's an important lesson that we can learn from the peace process of North Ireland. Yes, thank you very much. Oh, Ms. Lisa Clark, would you like to also add some comments? No comment?
No, I don't think so. Thank you. Not much on governments, I'm afraid.
Yeah, 고맙습니다.
Yes, thank you.
So from the audience who is present here today, we don't have much time, so please be very brief with your question. The consideration for the others, as was mentioned by our moderator. Well, along with that, I believe that introspection, taking a closer look at ourselves, would be important as well. Are we ready for unification? We have the UNC issue, the turnover of the OPCON command. So, I mean, if we do have a peace treaty or peace agreement, what's going to happen? Even if we reach a peace treaty, it may break down in the future. So if we do have a breakdown of the peace treaty, what are we going to do? That will mean war readily. And so after we conclude a peace treaty, and through long-term discussion, if there's a breakdown, there's a high possibility that we're going to have war. So before we conclude a peace treaty, what kinds of preparations should we engage in to ensure that the peace treaty will be maintained over a long period of time? Dr. Kim, would you like to answer?
Yes, Dr. Kim, can you briefly answer that question? Thank you very much for that important question. I believe that there are many challenges along the way of preparation, and we can even call this a South-South conflict because there are internal conflicts, and it was the same case for Ireland. So I believe that it's important to look into the examples of other peace processes around the world. It's not just that for the academia or for the government. I think that also the citizens need to stay tuned to all of these different types of peace processes around the world. Recently, I've been participating a group of teenagers of both North and South Ireland in the border areas. On a monthly basis, they have Zoom meetings. And I can say that the teenagers have a lot to say. There can be issues that are very difficult to deal with in everyday society, and there are also confrontational issues, especially in the political sphere. But you can see that there is this free discussion of teenagers on these contentious issues. This indicates that the experience of peace processes around the world should be shared, which will help us raise the possibility of forging a peace agreement and also understand some of the future challenges even after the peace process or the peace agreement. And I hope that we can have more of these for us in the future. Yes, thank you very much. And if I may add to that, at least when it comes to unification and North Korean policies or inter-Korean issues, I believe that we have to break away from just a political discourse, but we need to build a separate type of governance to solve these issues. What I want to say is that it could be the Progressive Party or the Conservative Party, but it's true that with the change of administration, we cannot sustain these long-term policies. So under the current situation, North Korean policies or inter-Korean policies will only have to change every 5 years as the administration changes. You can see that this big picture changes as there is a change of administration. And such fragmented policies will continue on. And for the counterpart, it would seem like, well, we're always taking a different stance every time there's a change of political circle. And what kind of credibility will that offer to the counterpart? Of course, there are issues with the North as well, and that's another topic. But for us, I would like to say that these issues, at least for it to be resolved when it comes to unification and inter-Korean issues, we need to build a steadfast or a robust governance. And only then can we solve peace agreement issues as well as any provocations that may arise from the North. And with this strong governance structure, I think that we can actually come to a better resolution to all of these issues. I went to Okinawa And if you go to the Mauni Hill, there is a peace monument. During the Okinawa Pacific War, this hill indicates more than 236,000 names that were sacrificed at war. So we have this peace monument on this hill. I believe that in the DMZ, during the Korean War, we had the Korean Communist Army, the UN forces, the Korean forces, and the North Korean forces, and they died. And we have their relics. And of course, there were some joint expeditions where we saw the ruins and the relics of the war of certain forces, especially the Chinese forces. And they were sent out to China from Korea. So depending on which location we're talking about, you can see that an enemy can become a major patriot if you move out to a different jurisdiction. And I believe that like this peace monument in Okinawa, we need something like that here in the DMZ. You can see that through this unjustifiable war, there were so many sacrifices, and there are these souls that I believe we need to find a way to soothe. And if we can have certain monuments to pay respect and pay tribute to these souls in the border area, it will help us expand this consensus for the need and the necessity for peace. So last but not least, Lord Frost has the poem Mending Wall. You can see that nature, if we erect walls, they try to bring down the wall as a defrost during the spring season after the winter. Some say that with a stronger wall, we have friendly neighbors. However, nature did not want erecting walls. So every time through the defrost, you can see that they brought down the walls by human beings in this poem. So you can see that it's not only about Robert Frost's poem. You can see that for vested interests, we see artificial walls being erected. These barriers, these borders are put in place, but we have to bring them down. And you can see that those that have any love for peace also need to put in the effort to bring down these barriers that hinder peace. So with that, let me conclude this roundtable session. I would like to extend my gratitude to all of our participants. Thank you very much.
네, 좌담회를 이끌어주신 최양규.
I'd like to thank Director Won Kyu Che for leading the session, and to our panelists also, a warm round of applause. This concludes the symposium of the DMZ Global Forum 2020. From 1 in the afternoon, we will have sessions 1, 2, and 3. Session 1 on peace, women, and youth will be in this hall. Session 2 on history, culture, and tourism will be in the Imgokjeong Hall. Session 3 on environment, ecology, Han River estuary will be held in Hantangang River. Session 1 will be broadcast live via MOU YouTube channel, UNITV. Sessions 2 and 3 will be recorded and uploaded on the YouTube channel at a later time. So we look forward to your participation in the afternoon sessions as well. For those of you who are here today, please finish your lunch and be back in the respective